In this Easter season, as we wait for the Lord's ascension and Pentecost, we have various versions of the resurrection gospel, the Easter gospel. And today, on this feast of Jesus the Good Shepherd, once again, we have very strong references to Jesus laying down his life on behalf of us, his flock. It's a little bit like looking at a painting, a beautiful painting. We may have seen it before, we may have seen it several times before, but each time we look at it more carefully, we begin to see details in that painting that we hadn't noticed before. They may be minor details, but we see how beautiful they are and how they enhance that painting. Or it's like looking at a gem that has many facets, and we turn that gem in our hands and we allow those facets to radiate the different colors, the different hues. See how beautiful it is. And so it is then during this Easter season, we look at the mystery of Jesus' life, death, and his resurrection, and we keep coming back to that, to look at it from other angles, other dimensions, to see details that we had not seen before. That's the beauty of this season we call Easter and our Easter faith. It's a time for us to appropriate this Easter faith. Hopefully we did that on Saturday before Easter, the Easter Vigil service, or on Easter Sunday, but that's not enough. We need to continue to appropriate that Easter faith and to make it our own, so that somehow this Easter is better than any Easter we've celebrated before, because we've taken time to look at it, to appreciate it, to see some details that we've missed in the past. And if that's true, if we're able to do that, then it becomes something that transforms us. It's something that regenerates us. It brings about in us a new birth. Although we've already been born in baptism, we are reborn again because of the fact that we celebrate in a special way with attention this Easter season to these details. And so it's a way of thinking and living differently than the world does. Sometimes we're puzzled because we see the world, at least as St. John speaks about it in the second reading today and elsewhere in his gospel, in a negative sense. You say, well, how is that possible? If you look out and you see what a beautiful world we have this spring morning, how can we see it in any negative way? Yesterday, I thought I'd take some time out. I live right next door to where Nature Center, and I went for a walk, but it was a very slow walk because I wanted to appreciate the details around me, the wildflowers. So I took my backpack and I had a bird book and I had two flower books and I had binoculars. I have all of this stuff to just take time to appreciate it. And so I named, or at least I recognized, about 15, and there are many more, of the wildflowers. But it took time to identify some of them because I either forgot the names or I never knew them. And the same thing with birds too. Right now it's a wonderful time because they're migrating. And I have a number of bird feeders at home, and I put up this one for the orioles, and I put oranges in there, and it's near my window, and they're coming. They're coming, and it's such a joy to see these beautiful birds as they come to eat the oranges. How can anyone speak of the world in a negative way? We're talking now about God's creation as he'd given it to us. When St. John talks about the world, it's in a negative sense, in the sense that it's that part of humanity that does not know Christ or that refuses to believe in Christ. That's the world that he speaks about. And as a result of that, he sees in the world values that are contrary to the gospel. Prejudice, violence, the use of force, selfishness, greed, many of these other things John lumps together when he speaks about the world. And as a matter of fact, it's these things that in many ways distort and destroy God's creation. We know that. And so in the second reading today, John once again speaks about the world. He says, it's because of our Easter faith that there should be something unique about us. People should say, what happened to you? Or why is it that there's something different about you? We don't do that intentionally. But because of this Easter faith, something has or should have changed in us. Maybe to the point where people would even notice it and say, what is it that's different about you this year? It's our Easter faith. The answer is that we've chosen intentionally to follow the Good Shepherd. We possess this Easter faith in which penetrates more deeply into the mystery and the meaning of Jesus' resurrection. What's it all about, this resurrection of Jesus? Why is it so all important? Like a painting, there may be aspects of this resurrection of Jesus that we've missed in the past, and now we're coming back to it to appreciate it more fully. Coming to understand how this mystery of his death and resurrection impacts on us. It means for us freedom, the greatest freedom possible, the freedom from our sins, from our addictions, from all of those things that separate us from God and from one another. It means joy and peace, the promise of eternal life. These things nobody can give us. We can't purchase them. We don't go out to acquire them on our own. They come with this Easter faith. Also, it means coming to recognize a deeper potential power in each one of us to bring healing to others. In the first reading today, Paul has just healed the man who was crippled. And it seemed like it was an easy thing to do, but it really wasn't, because he ran into all kinds of opposition. There were those who accused him of not following the Jewish prescriptions. There are those who accused him of following Jesus instead of the Jewish law. And so what he did then, in a sense, created problems for him. But he overlooked all of those. He overlooked all of those because he saw what he needed to do. He needed to continue the healing work of Jesus, which we know our Lord did so much of in the gospel. He was enthusiastic about his faith. The word enthusiastic is an interesting one because it means in God, or God in him. It was just spilling over. There was something different about Peter. He's filled with this enthusiasm. And so in the face of opposition and threats and ridicule, he nevertheless brought healing to the cripple. A new life to this man who was not able to walk before. With Easter faith, we recognize our own crippleness, our own limitations and imperfections, and that's okay. That's the way it should be. We stand in need, therefore, of healing and nourishment from Jesus, the Good Shepherd, and that is the way it should be. But we also recognize a new potential in each one of us because of this Easter faith, to bring healing to others, to feed and to nourish them, to comfort them, as Jesus, the Good Shepherd, did. And with Easter faith, we're much more grateful for what God has done for us and take a lot less for granted. We become generous and confident as Peter did. And as I mentioned at the beginning of our Mass this morning, we welcome those who are not part of this flock. We become a welcoming community. There are others, Jesus says, who must be welcomed to join us. All persons everywhere, especially those on the fringes of society. As Jesus did in welcoming unwashed and filthy shepherds and foreigners, treacherous tax collectors, abused prostitutes, and so many others who've fallen between the cracks of society. Easter faith can transform us, maybe not completely, but it continues to do so. It brings us into closer identification with our risen Lord. And then finally, at the end, as the reading suggested, there'll be the ultimate vision where we'll see God as he is. St. John says, "Dearly beloved, we are God's sons and daughters now. What we shall be has not yet come to be. We know that when it comes to light, we shall be like him and we shall see him as he is." That too is Easter faith.